Hey, I'm Mel.
And I'm Andres, and you're listening to
Mixedtape, your favorite Afro-Latin podcast.
What she said.
Today's single title is inspired by the song No Podrán Destruir Mi Vida, They Won't Be Able to Destroy My Life, by Super Orquesta EPA. No podrán destruir.
Bravo yo que soy mulato oscuro, tengo la mente en mi sitio y estoy bueno de salud.
Today we're listening to Pa Bravo Yo by Justo Betancourt. Justo is an Afro-Cuban singer born in 1940 in Matanzas, Cuba. Among the bands he was part of is the orchestra Borincuba, which he created in the 70s. The name Borincuba is a combination of two words, Borinquen, the Taino name of La Isla de Puerto Rico, and Cuba. The name of the band captured its combination of Cuban and Puerto Rican musicians. In Pa Bravo Yo, Justo talks with swagger and pride about his qualities as a highly skilled Afro-Cuban singer. He starts by saying, Pa Bravo Yo, yo que soy mulato oscuro, tengo la mente en mi sitio y estoy bueno de salud. You want brave? Here I am, a dark-skinned mulatto, with a clear mind and a good health. Justo then continues displaying his pride of hearing African blood. He sings, Pa bravo yo, yo que tengo sentimiento, tengo sangre de africano y canto con gran virtud. You want brave? Here I am, a man with strong feelings, with African blood, who sings with great virtuosity. Pa bravo yo is then a song about black excellence, Justo Betancourt's black Afro-Cuban excellence. Welcome to our first single. This is Mixedtape.
In this episode, we are introducing singles. Singles are episodes that might appear out of sequence from what we have originally planned to deliver. They might be centered around a pressing issue or related to a particular topic of interest. In this single, we check in about coping and talk about empathy as it relates to consuming distressing news about police brutality and racism. We also spend some time talking about the late Chadwick Boseman and his impact on the culture.
Hey everyone, this is Mel.
And this is Andres.
And we are coming to you today doing something a little different than what we have done over the past few episodes.
Yeah, so we... as probably you all also have done lately, we've been doing some reflecting, not necessarily focused on of how the extent to which racism keeps showing up and grabbing our attention and our resources. And we wanted to take the time, take a minute to reflect about that and how it's affecting us as part of the community and as part of just being human beings.
Yeah. Our original plan was to do a reflection video or a podcast mm-hmm. on the content that we've been providing you all with the guests that we've been having on the show. And we're still going to do that.
Yeah.
We're just going to delay that a week. But we wanted to be sensitive to what's happening in our country, in the United States, and kind of just take a minute to step back, reflect, like Andres was saying. The reality is it's very easy to listen to terrible news about death and harm and violence and racism and say, oh, damn, right? Mm-hmm. And then just keep it moving. So yeah. We don't want to subscribe to that kind of response.
That's great that you're saying that, because I feel like this time what happened with Jacob is...
Well, why don't you... I think we can assume that most people know what happened, but
yeah, of course. What we're referring to is to the what I'm going to call the attempted execution of Jacob Blake,
who was shot 7 times in the back in front of his kids who were in the car.
Mm-hmm. By a police officer.
By a police officer. That's important to say. Yes. So that's what we're referring to, and that's what it's bringing us to this sort of pause that we're doing relative to what we had planned in the podcast. And I don't know, from my point of view, this is in the same level of gravity that, or I would put in the same level of gravity where I would put what happened with George Floyd and with Breonna Taylor as well, and, mm-hmm. and you know, countless many more Black folks. But I do think that for this one in particular, for this event, we've been doing a little bit of the let's try to move on, mm-hmm. Or it's a bit my impression, maybe this is just me, because I think we've been numb before. It's not, I think that's what I'm trying to say. I think we're getting numb again, mm-hmm. because it's sort of this defense mechanism that people who suffer have developed. It's your way to deal with the immense pain that comes with this events. You had to somehow still keep living.
Right.
And keep operating, right? Yeah. You have to provide for your family, you have to still be part of a community, and that kind of thing. And one way, human way to do that is to get numb. I think I have experience in that from as a Colombian. We've had a pass of massacre after massacre after massacre after massacre. Nowadays, we have an uptake in massacres. Mm-hmm. Of
you post social, about that yeah, social, on our Instagram page yeah, often
of social leaders, by which I mean indigenous leaders, Afro-descendant leaders have been killed more often in the last years, and this is what I was coming from when I said you just kind of get numb to it,
yeah,
which makes you feel guilty because you're like I wish I didn't feel this numbness to the terrible event over a terrible event over a terrible event. And I feel like as a society in the US, there's a little bit of numbness that it's sort of been developed during the last months in reaction to...
Over the past years, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like something happens and then people feel not... People grieve and then something else happens and... There's a lot of different emotions that people experience, and we'll talk about that more. Today we'll talk about coping, mm-hmm. Lack of coping mechanisms, and coping mechanisms, mm-hmm. because I think we tend to have both. And just to say really quickly, you know, this relates to the podcast because the original reason that we wanted to do this podcast was because we were talking about what happened with George Floyd, and Andres mm-hmm. and I started talking or having so many conversations about racism as it exists in a lot of different places.
Yeah.
Because we spend so much time in the dance community, we were like, let's investigate this, or let's mm-hmm. talk this out a little more. And that's how we got to Mixedtape in the content that we're bringing you related to dance, but the true foundation of developing this podcast is because of the police brutality that exists in the United States and, I mean, in many other places around the world, but specifically to Black people.
Yeah.
And so that's why it's important to pause and have this conversation today.
Yeah, and I would add to that on top of that, I would add that this is sometimes we think of the community, of the dance community, as you know, we all meet in the social and there's nice people that are nice to you for the most part, and you're excited to go. But as you were saying, dancing, and honestly, as some of or if not all of our guests have said, dancing is nothing but a microcosm mm-hmm. of the rest of our lives. Mm-hmm. And some of us have the privilege to not think about things that are happening, in particular the latest one that has to do with Jacob. But some of us don't. For some of us, that's very close to home and it feels heavy. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this, of course, now we're in the middle of this pandemic, so we're not even meeting for socials, but things like this have happened before. And I assure you that the Black people that you saw in the socials around what happened in Ferguson and around other events, so some of the other multiple events that have happened, were dealing with those kinds of issues in their heads as they were in the socials. Mm. So this is just another part of their lives that they don't get to dissociate from. And that energy is brought into right. also. And again, the music itself that is played in these spaces carries that weight and that pain, also the love and the strength, but also carries that weight.
Yeah. So what I hope for what comes out of this conversation is that we can share some of, like I said, our coping mechanisms and just how we're responding to this. And also for, like you said, those people who have the privilege to not have to enter into this grief because
mm-hmm. that's very important.
Because if they're outside of it, because they may not be Black or may not care that someone has gotten shot 7 times in the back in front of their children.
That's very important. Let me interject you to ask you something because you said that, and I think that's super relevant as to what does it mean to be a human being in this context. Like, does it mean that you get to say, oh, I'm your ally, like, I'm sorry this happened to you, or should you be grieving as well?
For me, I think something like this warrants grief. Anyone who watched that video, and I'll be honest, I waited maybe 2 days before watching that video. Watching those things is really hard for me. Anyone who had watched it, anyone who had heard about what happened, I think should be sad. That's a sad thing to have happened. That's an awful, horrific thing to have happened. And I don't think it requires you being Black. And I don't think it requires you being male. I don't think it requires you being a parent to be able to be sad about that happening.
Exactly. And I think the reason why I think what you're saying is very, very important, besides the point of, you know, moral philosophy and why seeing another fellow human being being murdered for no reason should guarantee,
or paralyzed in this case, that, you know, he's paralyzed now,
wearing your grief, it's because it's a concept of empathy that you can translate to so many other injustices that happen. Mm-hmm. And if we are unable to practice that kind of human empathy in an event like this, in which somebody gets shot 7 times in the back and gets paralyzed in front of their kids, I'm not sure when it is that we're going to practice that empathy. Mm-hmm. Like, what are we waiting for our empathetic capital to be spent on?
Yeah, I think empathy is a difficult skill to develop. So it's different than sympathy, right? Sympathy is like, I feel bad for you. Mm-hmm. And empathy is, I feel bad with you, right? And I think people are very familiar with sympathy because they're not entering into the grief and entering into the pain or the struggle of the context.
Yeah.
You know, you hurt yourself, dang. That sucks. You know, that's sympathy, right? Empathy is, I'm so sorry.
Keep, you know, eating your ice cream or whatever.
Yeah, empathy is, I'm really sorry that happened to you. That must have felt terrible, mm-hmm. right? And people haven't developed that language or that practice. And when this is especially true when you're not in that same space as the people who are being harmed. Exactly. So I'll say it probably requires, and I don't know if it does because I'm not white. It probably requires a lot more. It requires a lot of conscious effort for someone who is white to enter into that space empathetically, because the language might not have been developed for the context, and but traditionally they've been trained.
But it's selective empathy. It's human being after human being after human being after human being for a very specific race that can be murdered in this country.
It's a historical thing though, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know if I mentioned this in one of the podcasts, I think I did, that I've been listening to Stamp from the Beginning on audiobook. In this book, he goes over so much racism for hundreds of years, and for people who are white and who operate with privilege, there's a lot of undoing that needs to happen psychologically to be able to enter into this space to be empathetic for people of color. That's not my problem.
Yeah.
That's something that white people need to figure out on their own.
And that's
not an excuse also. Like that. That's not an excuse.
And that is, if you can say something about this, and that is related to this, who said, one of our guests said this about, I think it was Sharita, about we don't need allies. We need you to be doing your job that you have to do to get out of this sort of isolation of empathy that you have, this island of empathy that only goes for people of your race in this case. And it, for some reason, it prevents you from being empathetic with another fellow human being that just happens to be of a different color. I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done. And to complement that, this reminds me of a conversation that I was having with a friend. When George Floyd was murdered, I was trying to explain to her how do you approach this work of feeling empathy at the baseline level that I think needs to be developed, because they were like, yeah, you know, it's pretty bad, but you know, I'm just gonna keep doing my thing. Like, and I was like, no, that's, and I'm not asking you to be sad for the sake of being sad. That's not the point. I'm saying, if you really want to understand the extent to which this affects people of color, Black people specifically in this country, what you need to do is, regardless of your race, regardless of how much money you have, regardless of your religion, think of your father, think of your brother down under this officer's knee being murdered for 8 minutes in front of everybody. But really picture that in your head and think, try to simulate what would you feel and how you feel after that. And if that doesn't take you closer to that baseline level of empathy, I don't know what's going to do it for you.
Yeah. And we were talking about this yesterday, something that constantly comes up, right, is that people can't even enter into that space because now they want to develop a narrative about who the victim was.
Yeah.
The victim in this context being Jacob Blake or George Floyd. People want to develop a narrative of how bad this person was to have deserved death, to have deserved pain. And that bothers me so much. It bothers me because, and I tweeted about this and I posted this, and who knows, maybe I'll post it again. It bothers me because it's like a selective contextualization of events.
Yeah.
So when this happens, you know, people dig up their entire history, who they were, who their mother was, who their father was, what they've done. And does him being shot, do we have to see him as having been a saint? No. Is it terrible that maybe he was involved in some things? Of course it's terrible. Does that warrant violence and death.
It doesn't warrant execution.
It doesn't warrant execution. It doesn't. And so, like, people contextualize these situations, but they don't contextualize poverty. And they don't contextualize a wealth gap.
Yeah.
And they don't contextualize education gap.
No, and on top of that, they are so happy to brag about the, you know, the laws and we are a country of law and order, but if there's an illegal execution, mm-hmm. they're like, oh, well, you know.
What law is that? Yeah, what order
is that?
You know,
he was dealing cigarettes. And I was like, okay, we're going to start killing people because they're dealing cigarettes. Mm-hmm. You know, how are we going to deal with the people having stealing land from the indigenous people, mm-hmm. like with this big company? So how are we going to deal with the corrupt people? Like those, you know, right. that's a whole more damage right. than selling a couple of cigarettes in the streets of New York. Like, we need to put things into, and by we need to, it's not us, right? So that's not what we're, and I'm not.
We just can't have selective contextualization. We can't have that. And what's missing from the context in the story that people try to develop about these people who are being harmed or who have been harmed or killed is racism.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, it feels like a very obvious part of the story.
Yeah. And I think something that's key in what you said is the word selective, mm-hmm. because this is not for a lot of people. And this is my view for a lot of people. This is not, you know, we just happen to not get it. It's not that you're choosing when to apply the abilities of empathy that we all human beings for the most part have, unless mm-hmm. we're a sociopath or something, mm-hmm. but most of us are not sociopath. So we choose very specifically who do we want to use that empathy with. And there's a huge gradient of race that goes through that selection, as you were mentioning, and it clearly has to do with racism.
Yeah, and it also requires a significant level of selflessness.
Yeah.
So to enter into grief with someone or to enter into someone else's pain and suffering, it requires you to give some of yourself into that.
Yeah.
And if you're talking to someone who doesn't feel affected by it and requesting that they enter into this space from you, that's taking some of themselves. And the selfish thing to do is to say, well, I'm not going to offer that because it doesn't matter to me. I don't feel like exerting that energy to enter into that space. And it's a selfish act.
And obviously that. It's understandable that empathy cannot work ad infinitum, by which I mean, you cannot be empathetic with every single human being that exists in this planet.
Unless you're me.
But like, to be honest with ourselves, like, there's a whole lot of terrible things that are happening right now, and we all know about it. Like, I know about the terrible things that are happening in Colombia. Am I doing as many things as I could be doing? No, I'm still trying to live my life, mm-hmm. and I understand that we all are trying to live our lives to a certain degree of joy, while we also, some of us at least, try to make some change or help make some change. I think we need to do better in terms of exposing ourselves more to what you were saying, basically being selfless and entering these spaces and be willing to donate some of that emotional energy that we have.
Mm-hmm. And it's hard. You're right. You can't, not that you can't be empathetic about everything, or maybe you can't.
I don't think it's
very difficult. Yeah. Very, very difficult to be empathetic about everything and have some ounce of happiness, because it requires such a bandwidth.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have a large bandwidth
you
to be able
have
to
enough
to,
emotional energy no. to worry about the things that happen in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia, and or even time to think about these things. Yeah. And like, what am I going to do with everything?
That's in addition to the things that are happening in your personal life.
So we understand. Yeah. So it's clear that this requires an investment of time and emotional energy, but in the specific case of the US, where it's so in your face and it goes through it ends up showing up in the distribution of wealth in black women dying at higher rates at giving birth, and, mm-hmm. and all of these things, they're so much of a part of the same sort of systemic racism problem that at some point it cannot only be Black people trying to fix things for themselves.
Yeah, and you know, there's, I don't know, was it the World Health Organization? Someone has, or the CDC, I don't remember, mm-hmm. but has identified racism as a public health issue. And it really is, because when we're talking about the people who end up taking on the emotional toll of everything that's happened, it's, yes. it's significantly Black, Indigenous people of color. Mm-hmm. And so if white people are functioning in a world where they're not impacted by this emotionally, financially, whatever it may yeah. be, they're not taking on this additional stressor that really impacts your mental health.
I mean, that actually leads us to continue with what we're going to do today, which is, I'm going to go ahead and ask you, how are you coping with this?
Oh, man. I wish I would have prepared better for this question. And I mean, I have been thinking about it since we thought about this. I don't think I've been coping optimally.
What do you mean by optimally?
So I'll start by saying that racism is emotionally draining.
Yeah.
Very emotionally draining. And when you care about people and the impacts of racism and think about it, I mean, every day, for people who are following me on Instagram, I post every morning, what are you doing today to function from an anti-racist
paradigm? Is that a reminder for you or for people?
It's a reminder for me. It's a reminder for me.
That's what I think every time I see it.
People have asked, mm-hmm. Or people have said, thank you for posting this every day. And my response is always, I post it because it's a reminder for me.
So that I don't forget.
Yeah, because it's very easy to forget.
Yeah.
So, and I mean, it's, I kid you not, it's the first thing I think of in the morning and I post it.
But it's a voluntary investment that you're doing.
Yeah.
Because you consider that to be important,
mm-hmm.
and to be something that, as humans, we're like very quickly try to move on from these traumatic things, mm-hmm. and you're saying, or this is how I interpret when I see your post.
And people have asked me, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And I'll say, I'm reading, mm-hmm. The podcast.
Yeah.
I am, you know, whether it's spending money, mm-hmm. or being more conscious of the way that I'm spending money, but the people I support, those yep. kinds of things. So I, when these things happen, what I tend to do is kind of, I don't want to say shut down. I turn off the news.
I see.
It's either, it's two extremes. I either turn off the news
or go all in, and
or I'm obsessed
Google
by the
all.
News. Yes. So it's one or the other. And then just to put some things into context, there was this thing called StrengthsFinder that I took in college. It's an assessment of your strengths. There's like, I don't know, 52 different types of strengths you can
yeah.
have, maybe 30 something, I might be exaggerating. But there's these list of strengths that you can have. And when I took the test, my number one strength was empathy. In college, I thought that was whack. I was like, what kind of a strength is empathy? This was before I became a social worker,
I
wasn't even interested in social work. But I was like, what kind of strength is empathy? This is whack. And my mentor was just like, that's beautiful. Strength to have. I was like, it's beautiful, but it's not strong. Like, you know, so this has been in me, and it's developed into social work and therapy and all mm-hmm. of those things. But so I feel the weight of things very hard emotionally. I feel really hard with many things, but specifically when things like this happen.
Mm-hmm.
So some of the things that are successful for me in coping that I haven't done the best job of doing is being outside, whether it's going for a walk, being with family usually helps.
So I'm going to ask you a related question, but it's actually before coping. What do you do in the first half an hour after you learn this news about Jacob?
After I learned about Jacob.
Yeah. Like what goes through your life in those half an hour?
After I watched the video?
Yeah.
Okay, because there was 2 days where I decided not to watch the video. I think subconsciously that's a part of me wants to distance myself from what's happened because I know it's going to take a lot.
Yeah, so you're like, let me wait until I'm ready for what I know
it's going to happen. And that's a privilege because people are not all people can be put in a position where they can wait 2 days.
His father couldn't wait.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. And that's a privilege that I recognize that I had in that moment. But afterwards, I don't go on reading more about the details. I might be silent for a little while and think. And what gets me riled up is when I go on Facebook and read essays about why someone deserved to be harmed. So it starts with this sadness and this heaviness, and then it develops into anger.
I see.
And frustration.
I see. So first sadness and then mm-hmm. anger. Mm-hmm. Mine is the opposite. My immediate reaction is anger. And this may have to do with your ability to feel empathy. I see this and I feel anger, like deep anger. And this is not, I mean, again, my Colombian past, it's been the same feeling since I remember. It's, you just see the injustice and I feel like in my face, like it's just so mm-hmm. much rage.
Mm-hmm.
I have to remove myself from saying anything in social media because I would say things that I would probably not want in my public image as a professor of economics at USC. But it's a lot of rage. It probably lasts more than half an hour, I think. Mm-hmm. So my first half an hour is pretty much just rage. And it's this balancing between the why and the I can't believe that mm-hmm. that this is still happening, and the rage of what am I doing? Am I doing enough?
Is the shock factor still there, do you think?
The shock, yeah, explain.
You just said it, sometimes you're thinking, I can't believe this is happening again. Is it like a frustration, I can't believe this is happening, or it's just like, this is still happening?
It's frustration, and it's a little bit like, you know, this numbness that I was talking about before. It's like it's like the numbness lasts until the event happens. So as soon as the event happens, it's like the numbness goes away. So I'm just as enraged mm-hmm. as I was mm-hmm. the last time.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel, this is what I really feel. I feel powerless. Like I wish, you know, again, I'm an atheist, but that's one moment in which I was like, if there's a God, can you please intervene and do something? Fix this injustice. It's too much to carry. It's too much to grieve. It's too much to see it as a human being happen. And this is what we were talking about at the beginning. You're a human and you see this happen. And how can you continue with your day? I do not understand that.
Speaking of how do you continue with your day, we're not the only ones working. We're not the only ones taking online dance classes. Yeah, yeah. We're not the only ones. You know, there are things that are happening in our everyday life. How does this impact the way that you spend the rest of your day or weeks or months?
So the rest of the day is a mess. I'm not gonna lie. The rest of the day is a mess. I've unfortunately already checked out from a lot of interactions with people at the economics department at UNC for reasons that we haven't talked here, but at some point maybe we'll share. They have to do with racism as well. I checked out even more. So interactions with people that I don't consider as feeling the empathy become very difficult for mm-hmm. me, almost to the point that I'm like, how can you continue without not at least acknowledging
what's happening? Would you say that's new for you, a new feeling? And I say this because with all the other acts that had been televised of police brutality, murder, violence.
Yeah.
In my educational spaces, those had not in the past really been brought up
mm-hmm.
in those contexts. Here, I think because institutions,
yeah.
schools are developing more of an awareness of how racism and these acts of police brutality impact students, and universities are beginning to take a stance on where they are
mm-hmm.
In regards to their position on the matter. It's become part of regular emails, right? Yeah. At least with UNC. All that to say, there are some people who, professionals, professors, who reach out to the Black students in my program and say, mm-hmm. hey, I heard about what happened, and I'm sorry this happened, and you are wonderful, you're marvelous. I'm sorry that this is something that you have to deal with emotionally. I'm here.
Yeah.
And then there are others who it's like it didn't happen, and meetings can be run yeah. as normally as they would have if someone had not been shot 7 times yeah. in the back.
I mean, I'm thinking about, not that I've received any emails like that in a timely manner from, at least from the AHM department, but now I'm thinking, what are they going to do now? They're going to send another email saying, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but mm-hmm. this happened. Mm-hmm. I know this is awful. Just, what is this, 2 months after what just happened? And
what tools do you have or have you developed to cope successfully? What successful tool have you developed, if any?
Successful, that's a big question. I don't think I have developed anything that's successful. For coping, I have what I do for coping, which is I put it in a box and then I throw it to the back of my heart
mm.
and then it stays there and I pretend it never happened. Now I pretend it never happened from the point of view of emotions. I do not pretend it never happened from the point of view of action. So I go out and, you know, we're doing the mm-hmm. podcast, I invest in I put money in Black and brown businesses, I donate. But for me, emotionally, since I think I have something similar to you, I feel these things very deeply.
Mm-hmm.
If I was to feel this way every day for weeks at a time, that would drain me down, which is what happened with George Floyd, honestly. Mm-hmm. I had co-authors of me saying, hey, you know, are you depressed? Or what's going on with you? You've not been the same for weeks. Like,
mm-hmm.
What it is that's going on with you. So that's one time in which I think George Floyd was one instance in which I couldn't even do that.
Mm-hmm.
But that's my yeah. way. I mean, I don't think it's successful at all.
No, yeah.
But that's and that has to do with my childhood and how mm-hmm. you know how that developed. But that's my tool, is just mm-hmm. box it and try to contain the damage emotionally.
Yeah.
And
I did see a article, I think it was a TED article, and it was specific to depression, but I think this can be useful for any kind of like emotional experience that people have to a stressor or traumatic event like this, right? So the TED article was how to, if you know these emotions are going to come up specifically related to depression, how do you put things in place to address it when it comes?
Yeah.
So I could post it on the Facebook page. I think it could be useful. It doesn't come from a anti-racist perspective. Yeah. It comes from a strictly a depression
mm-hmm.
Perspective. But I think some of the things that were put into the article could be useful for but people.
Honestly, as you were saying before, you know, racism creates so many other issues and weights on the back of Black people in the US and around the world. And one of those, you know, a lot of them have to do with resources that you don't have the mm-hmm. access, or you have the education, or you can get into these places or those places. Or guess what? Wealth was built 300 years ago when our ancestors were slaves. And
when our ancestors were property.
Yeah. So
not even able to access any of that wealth at all.
They couldn't even vote, couldn't even have a business because it would be burned like in Tulsa. So to have people nowadays have that idea of, you know, Latinos or indigenous people or Black people, you know, they're just lazy because they don't have wealth. It's, you know, that's on them. That's BS, right?
It's not contextualized, right?
All the wealth that you have would be nothing without the people that you killed mm-hmm. and worked to death mm-hmm. so that you could build wealth. That wealth is literally the ancestors of a lot of people made into money. That's what that is. So I even lost track of what it is that we're talking about.
That's right. But I think we need to spend a little more time, each of us and probably everyone and anyone who's listening and anyone who doesn't listen.
Yeah.
Generally, I think we all need to be able to identify when that kind of heavy emotion is beginning to come on over us
and
I don't want to say kind of cope so that you don't have to feel the weight of it. I think it's perfectly fine to feel the weight of grief.
I think that's very
however fun. It can't put us in a position where we are immovable and unable to take action, and that takes so much awareness and practice, and we're gonna get it wrong all the time. But as long as we're working towards understanding those triggers of I'm starting to feel hot, I'm starting to feel heavy, I'm starting to feel really down. When you identify those things and can name it, and also use something to kind of help you re-regulate yourself to look at the issue with kind of a level mind.
And for people not grieving, and I would say for people that are not people of color not grieving, do you even know what happened?
Mm.
Why are you not grieving? This is a human being. And this is a legitimate question that I have, like what's, is there anything wrong with you? Haven't you seen what happened? Because this takes us back into that idea of, you know, those messages of, you know, you have to be, try to be empathetic with your Black and brown workers or classmates or coworkers, because they're, you know, they're going through this very hard thing that just happened that is, you know, the product of racism, which happens every day, but, you know, be friendly to them. No, don't be friendly. Do mm-hmm. your job. Be active. The thing that you post, what are you doing today to combat those structures of racism in society? Mm-hmm. Are you doing anything at all, or mm-hmm. are you just being friendly to your coworker because they're grieving?
And that's what you bring up. Like, I think what people don't want is pity.
Yeah.
And I say this all the time, and I struggle with pity.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want pity. I don't think people want you to feel badly for them.
Mm-hmm.
People want you to feel badly with them. Pity is useless.
It is.
It's useless.
If anything, I think pity is just a tool for the people that feel the pity to feel better about themselves. Like, I'm doing mm-hmm. something.
Mm-hmm.
I'm feeling pity for you, so mm-hmm. now I can feel good. Like, I was feeling a little bad, but now that I feel pity for you, I feel better.
Yeah.
And they don't actually do anything.
Yeah, it's a way to rid themselves of the task
of
feeling with you, feeling with you. Yeah,
it's like, oh,
it's useless.
Washing your hands. That's how it feels to me.
Keep your pity.
Which brings me to let's bring this back to, or try to link it back to the podcast. And we have to make a mental experiment here with y'all listeners and with you, Mel, because of course we can go dancing
out
and into socials, but it's worth asking ourselves, ask people of color, black people, and even white people, when something terrible happens like this, again, it has nothing to do with race. A human being got almost murdered for nothing, mm-hmm. With 7 shots in the back in front of their kids. You should feel some grief. I'm going to go ahead and use the should word there. What it is that we bring to the dance floor. And by what I mean is we have all these complex lives outside of dance floor. And then we meet in this friendly place and there's some nice music playing. Of course, if you speak Spanish and understand the songs, you will quickly realize that maybe it's not as happy as you thought.
Or even a matter of paying attention.
Yeah.
Right? Because the music is so rich. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes you don't even pay attention to the words.
Yeah. So what it is that we are bringing to these spaces? What do you bring, Mel, when you used to go out?
When I used to go
what
out.
What would you bring this nowadays?
Nowadays, I know typically if I was feeling down about something unrelated mm-hmm. to what's happening in the world,
yeah.
I would use dance to forget about what was happening.
Kind of now, as a getaway.
I think in part because of this podcast
yeah.
and what we're doing, I have a heightened awareness of my use of dance
mm-hmm.
In terms of it not being used as this escapism,
yeah.
But also used, and I was talking to my dad, shout out to my dad,
yeah.
who listens to the podcast. But
gives us feedback.
I was talking to him with him yesterday, and you know, there's this added level of respect to the dance after listening to everyone, and we'll reflect more on that
yeah.
next week. But I think now when we're able to come back into the space to social dance, there's definitely added respect. What's happening in the world cannot be minimized.
Yeah.
With dance, it can't. For me, it can't anymore.
And at the same time, I think two things.
Personally, sure. Yeah. I'm trying to minimize what's going on in my life, and I think it's
two things. It's at the same time that element can no longer be ignored from which, you know, exists in salsa as one of the ingredients of the music itself. This idea of dealing with racism and dealing with oppression and all of that in the songs and some of them that are in the playlist that we put together, but also a statement of rebellion in terms of, yes, there are a lot of horrible things that are happening and we're trying to do our best to combat them, and we're asking for people that are not as affected and have privilege to also do their job. A statement of rebellion in terms of, we also get to feel joy.
Mm.
So we come to the socials. Yes, it's heavy, and the music itself is heavy sometimes for those who pay attention to it or can understand it. But at the same time, if you listen to the songs, the reason why people sometimes confuse them is because they sound happy, because that's in purpose. Somebody writes a song because their brother dies from a drug addiction and they want to process that sadness, but then at the end of the day they want to come out
mm-hmm.
strong,
and music is its own form of yeah. coping.
Exactly.
So
we yes, we want to keep that awareness, and part of the idea of the podcast is because we want to build that awareness into the community, but we also want to make that statement of, they don't get to steal our joy.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, this is terrible, and they produce a lot of sadness and anger, but they don't get to steal our joy.
Yeah.
We still have our music, and we're still going to enjoy it. We're going to do the work that has to be done and that we can do, but the joy we get to keep.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's one thing they haven't been able to steal from us.
Yeah. I think that's an excellent way to end that part of our podcast. We wanted to touch on for maybe 5 minutes, if you all would listen for
yeah.
another few minutes, is we also want to be sensitive to other things that are happening in Black culture. And that
bad
is
bad news and bad news and bad news apparently lately.
Yeah. All I've seen on Facebook is just like, oh God, 2020 is just the worst. But the one thing is the passing of Chadwick Boseman, who is our king, T'Challa, our Black Panther.
Our Wakanda forever.
Yeah. And what that means, and we won't spend a long time on that, but we wanted to recognize his work and his impact. And just chat a little bit about what he represents.
The idea of having a powerful, Black, successful male figure representing the culture at the level that he did, and not only in the US, but internationally. Usually, and I can speak to that as a person that is not from the US, you know, you usually see the superhero being some white dude flying, or like, you're like, ah, that's
Superman, aka Superman.
Yeah, that's some, not no Sandy Cassette, like, okay, that's cool. You buy the toys, but they never, it doesn't feel as close. Seeing that it's possible for there to be, you know, a Black person, but you can extend that to anybody that is a minority, of course, immediately sympathizes, because like, okay, we can have a representation of somebody that's successful from our communities, and which is not broadcasted for to the extent that you don't even think that it's possible.
No, so black people tend to have the sidekick roles or comic relief in a show, and for him to be able to not only play this role, we were talking about, well, the writer plays the writes the film, right? But he stepped into the role specifically for Black Panther and many of the other films that he's starred in, which I've really enjoyed. But he stepped into the role and honored it and executed it responsibly.
That's very important.
Excellence. And
I think that's what's so striking about his passing is the way in which he did things. Because as you're saying, yes, these roles existed. We just lost one of the big lights that that was doing that job at such a great level. And not only in the entertainment way, but also in the ways he, whenever he got a chance to speak his mind outside of these acting roles that he also picked very selectively to be the ones that sort of were in line with his ideology. But whenever he got to speak, his words were very often also aligned with this idea of, you know, Black excellence and sort of displaying the possibility of it.
An added layer of grief in this situation is how he had lived with cancer for 4 years and had been taking on all these roles, in a sense, for us, for us, for Brendan, and I'm sure for him too, and in some way, and what that might have been for him.
But it's almost like he understood what this juncture in time, his very existence, was a representation of something larger than himself. I think he understood that and tried to make the most out of it.
And I think what has happened with his passing, and I mean, like, the world is sad, the world is grieving. It's kind of an invitation. It's an invitation to behave lovingly all of the time, to strive for excellence to the extent that you possibly can. To do for others and be there for others. And he had done that. He had extreme empathy in ways that we had not known, because, you know, we obviously didn't know what he was going through, but it shouldn't have to take knowing what someone is going through to exercise those behaviors of lovingness and excellence and kindness. And it shouldn't be only reserved for people who feel worthy to receive that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's very important, because it's the links it back to this idea that, you know, for a Black individual to be grieved and respected and missed has to be that they're exceptional.
Mm.
Right? That, like, you know, Chadwick, or maybe Kobe.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be like somebody that has done so much that, of course, we're going to miss them because of what they represent to the culture. But we have to get to the point, and I think this is, and I think Trevor Noah mentioned this the other day in one of his episodes, we want to get to the point in which we respect and appreciate Black people and Latinx people and queer people of color, and queer people in general, and just human beings, for the fact that they exist. Mm-hmm. And we don't have to expect from a certain population that for us to appreciate them and to value their lives, they have to have gone through so much
hell.
Yeah, hell, and succeed.
And succeed, out of it, yeah.
For us to, you know, be able to
gone like, through hell. Talks,
like, okay, now we care, yes, about transgender women because she made it.
Right. Go through hell, overcome hell, and not complain about it.
Yeah.
In order to respect somebody.
Yeah, we need to get to the point in which it's uneventful to be Black. It's uneventful to be Latinx. It's, yes, of course, it's your culture, and to that point it is eventful for you, but it shouldn't be eventful in the sense of, you know,
this exceptionalism, like, yeah, holding, yeah, on,
it should be like being just a human. Yeah, if you're, yeah, exceptional because, you know, you got what you got from birth or your grade or whatever, yeah, that's great, but it shouldn't take all of this immense amount of luck and success and work and community supporting you for a Black individual, for a minority individual, to be appreciated by the society.
Right.
And I think, right, something that I think the coach of the LA Clippers, since I've been watching basketball nowadays, said is it's amazing how Black people continue to love this country, and every time the country breaks their hearts,
mm,
by displaying this lack of love towards them. And yet, Black people continue to love the country, and it's incredible.
And Chadwick Boseman, what he embodied is resilience.
Yep.
Black people are resilient because they have to be. It's not. It just they have to be. It,
yes.
That is a requirement of being Black. A requirement of being a person of color,
yeah,
is resilience.
Yeah.
And I think many people don't recognize that.
Yeah, and it shouldn't have to be, which is,
right,
my, we shouldn't have to be the ones that are resilient and like strong and like the thing with the strong Black women, the same. That shouldn't be the necessity,
mm-hmm,
because as you're saying, those are traits that, it's not like they were, you know, we're all minorities, we're born with these traits. No, like,
you we learn just have to be, right,
because, yeah, well, there's no way out of it.
That's the only way to, exactly, survive.
We have to get to the point where, yeah, we don't have to be born with, or we don't have to be taught that we need to be so strong to, you know, succeed, have success regardless of all these terrible things that happen. No, we should be able to, like a white person, have success because, you know, we went to school and that was enough, mm-hmm, and maybe we got a job and it was great and we have a family and guess what, this is the, you know, we're just not jerks and take care of the environment, but that's all that it takes to be a nice human being. It doesn't have to, it shouldn't have to take so
there
much.
Isn't this added level of survival and situational, yes, awareness and resilience and living up to expectations of,
yeah,
people and all of those added stressors that, I mean, we experience every day, and it's heavy.
We should, exactly, we shouldn't need to be exceptional to be able to,
yeah,
to survive. And I think Chadwick's legacy, it's like both sides of this coin,
in, yeah, which
he is a display of, you know, they've been saying for so many years, a Black man, Black individual, I mean, or individual cannot be a successful person that anybody would want to be. Mm-hmm. Like I see his words and his work, and I'm like, man, I wish I was that successful. Like, I wish that was me. Like,
there was an interview where they were talking about, like, you know, even my white kids want to be Black Panther, yes, right? Exactly. And so it's like, such a paradigm shift for people that a white kid wants to be a Black man.
Yes,
you know, because he's powerful and amazing, mm-hmm. and you know, he's Black Panther. And that should be normal. Mm-hmm. That should be normal.
But you can aspire and be inspired by another human being that is a display of effort and success and just being a nice human being, mm-hmm. and humanism. So on the one hand, it's like, so that's the one side of the coin with Chadwick. And the other one is this recognition that it shouldn't take for a minority person, for a Black man, Black woman, or for a Black person to be Chadwick Boseman, mm-hmm. to be able to gain respect in this society. Yeah. So I think in a way he shows both of those notions.
So yeah, that's where Andres and I are on the state of racism and police safe, brutality, yeah. and grief and sadness. And you know, I hope after we drop this episode, we can hear a little bit from folks about some of the ways they successfully cope
or unsuccessfully
cope. Because yeah. I mean, the struggle is real. Like it's yeah. it's not easy to manage all those things. But we really hope to hear from you all about your opinions and thoughts on how you get through the days if you are Black, Indigenous, person of color. And if you are a white individual functioning in the United States and through privilege that is not afforded to yeah. other non-white folks, we'd love to hear too about yeah. how you have, like in my Instagram post, used your days to function from an anti-racist paradigm and to just the process of empathy. For you, I think is what I'm really curious about, if someone would be willing to share.
We encourage everyone that listens to this episode to just jump in the conversation and tell us, you know, this is how I do it, this is, you know, what I've seen other people do. And honestly, if you just want to tell your story, just tell the story, and because we need the community, and to take it back to the purpose of the podcast, we need the community to understand that those of us that cannot afford, as you were saying, that time out from society, mm-hmm. because we carry it around at all times, some of us much more than others, need for you to start listening and paying attention and exercising some of that empathy that I think you all have, and we just need to share it.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Well, thanks for listening, and we will hit you back with
our analysis,
an additional reflections podcast, but on the content of the previous episodes.
Yeah. I hope you all, you know, at least can sympathize with what we had to say today, or at least it led you to think critically about yeah. this.
If you're thinking more, I think we've done our job.
Achieved some, yes. Yeah. Yes. So thank you for listening. Yeah, interact with us on our platforms, Instagram, Facebook, you know, hit us up on the messages. Tell us how you're coping, what you're doing these days with all these things that have been happening.
Yeah. Peace.
Thanks for listening. Stay tuned for our reflection track next week. This is Mixedtape.